para algo, a dónde iremos. Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you for how you have been with us. Thank you for bringing us to your presence once again. Thank you because you have something wonderful in store for us today. Thank you because you have words to speak to us. Lord, I pray that our hearts will be open as we listen to you in Jesus' name. Even the person standing here, I pray that after everything, I will not be cast away in Jesus' name. Let your name be glorified. Holy Spirit, come and move with us in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name we pray. Let's open our Bibles to Matthew chapter 6. The reading from verse 7. Matthew chapter 6, verse 7. I want someone to read for us.
But when you pray, use not vain repetition as the ancients do, for they think that they shall be heard for their much speaking. Be not ye therefore like unto them, for your Father knoweth what things ye have need of before ye ask him. After this manner, thereof pray ye. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Praise the Lord. So today we're going to be looking at a very important study today. Prayer. So if I want to ask, who can just give a definition? What is prayer? We're all Christians, and this is like the basic foundation of a Christian life. Praise the Lord. Okay, prayer. Praise the Lord. So, a form of communication to God, appreciating God, telling him your heart desires, and then waiting to see what he wants you to do. Praise the Lord. I want another definition too. Should I call names? Okay, Stephen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Okay. Now, I have here some, should I say, pointers as to what prayer is. But I think before we start talking about it, we have to understand what is it that God actually expects. Why is it that we are commanded to pray? Praise the Lord. Now, let's put it this way. There's a family. There's a dad. And then there are children there. Praise the Lord. And now, the father has a wife and all that, which gave birth to the children in the first place. And then, now, the children have been born. They have been with their mother. Maybe they have not seen their father. At a point in time, they get in touch with their father. And they, this is my dad. And all that, you know, and they grow up like that. Now, every single day, the father wakes up in the morning, says, good morning, children. The children don't answer. It goes on and on like that. What do you say that kind of relationship is? Non-communicable relationship. Praise the Lord. So therefore, prayer is an act of communication with God. Let's just put it this way. Prayer is communication with God. Praise the Lord. And then it has origins. It has roots. Why do you commune with God? Why do you even pray in the first place? Praise the Lord. Let's open to Psalm 42 verse 1 and 2. Prayer is the soul's desire for God. That should be the first thing. Before we start thinking of prayers, presenting your request before God and asking of your heart desire, what is it that stems that prayer? What is it that makes you trust that as you open your mouth to talk to God, He will answer you? Praise the Lord. Psalm 42, verse 1 and 2. As the heart panted after the water brooks, so panted my soul after thee, O God. My soul thirsted for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? You can see that this person that wrote this psalm, it could be David, or it could be whoever it was that wrote this psalm. There was something inside him that longed for the presence of God. Praise the Lord. So even before he would ask anything, first thing, as he wakes up in the morning, God, that's what he's thinking about. So prayer is born out of, it comes from, and it should be. If it is not from this root, then it's questionable. Praise the Lord. It's born out of the love for God. Praise the Lord. So let us continue. So let me read what I wrote here. It says, prayer is a sincere desire of the soul of a man for the living God, born out of love, and it's an instinct. You know how it is that a baby naturally knows his mother, naturally cries when he needs something from the mother. It's an instinct. It should be the natural instinct. For instance, somebody is in a problem. Instead of calling somebody else, maybe picking up the phone to call someone to, please, oh, help me, give me money or something. First thing, as a human being, as a believer, the heart cries out to God. Praise the Lord. Born out of love, then it could be as a result of burdens, distress, turmoil, and most importantly, based on the word of God. Praise the Lord. Second thing is, prayer is a yearning, a deep stirring. There is a longing from the depths of your heart. There is a desire, in a way, in a sense, a strong desire that I've not prayed today. I've not been in the presence of my God today. Something is wrong with me. I need to go to his presence. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So, if it's based on love, what kind of love? It's a sincere desire from the deepest part of the heart to be in the presence of God. I think that's the basis of everything. Sometimes there's this question that I think I stumbled across, maybe not like a question, but then I portrayed it as a question before. Why do people want to get to heaven in the first place? Are we getting to heaven because there are mansions there that are fair and bright, and there are angels there that are flying about, and maybe there's heavenly food there for those of us that like food? Praise the Lord. Or is it because God is there? Do you understand? Now, there's somebody said something like, if God was not in heaven, would you still want to go to heaven? Do you understand? So, first things first, do you love God? So, before we start talking about prayer, intercession, bringing your request before God and all that, what is the basis? What is the root? Pray God to help us in Jesus' name. Let's open to Psalm 84, verse 2. My soul longeth, yea, even fainteth for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh crieth out for the living God. Yea, the sparrow hath found an house, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young. Even thine altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Blessed are they that dwell in thy house. They will still be praising thee. Selah. Selah means think on this. Praise the Lord. So therefore, the basis of it is love. Love for God. Sincere desire that can only be possible in the heart of a Christian. Why do you think the Bible says that the prayer or the sacrifice of the sinner is an abomination unto God? There's no basis. It's like something that is without a root. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I will follow him. Okay. Now, what is the essence of prayer? We'll get to that later. Now, this kind of prayer, I believe, is so much endeared to God. It is born out of pure love, gratitude, and tender reverence for God. Now, these requests are centered around Christ, not self. That's how somebody can pray in the will of God, according to the will of God. When your thoughts are centered on God himself, God, good morning, if you want, how are you? I know you see me and all that. I praise your name. What would you want to do with me today? What do you have for me today? What are we discussing? Okay, God. Okay, who is this person you want me to pray for? Do you understand what I'm saying? I'm just trying to paint a picture. Praise the Lord. Now let's open our Bibles again. Let's go to Psalm 63 from verse 1 to 3. Psalm 63 from verse 1 to 3. Say something.
Oh God, thou art my God. Early will I see thee. My soul thirsteth for thee. My flesh longeth for thee in a dry and thirsty land, where no water is. To see thy power and thy glory, so as I have seen thee in thy sanctuary. Because thy loving kindness is better than life, my lips shall praise thee.
Praise the Lord. From here, let's look at verse 3. It says, to see thy power and thy glory, so as I have seen thee in the sanctuary. Like when I was in the church, when I was in the service in the midst of the brethren, we all prayed together. You spoke to us and I felt your presence. Now I want to go back to my house and Lord, I want to feel the same presence. In fact, I want to carry the same presence everywhere I am going. I want to experience that same thing that I experienced when I was in the midst of the brethren. Praise the Lord. That's, I think, a very wonderful desire that I think God will answer that kind of prayer. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Now the next thing is, it is described as beseeching the Lord. Exodus chapter 32 verse 11. Beseeching the Lord. Exodus 32 verse 11. Can it be open, please? If anybody is there, please read. Praise the Lord. Seeking the face of God, calling upon the Lord, lifting up the heart, pouring out the heart. 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 25. Let's open it quickly, please. Many times we don't realize why, okay, maybe there's this question, right? God has given us choice and free will to make our own decisions, to choose to love him, to choose to serve him, because he doesn't want robots to serve him. He doesn't want people who, they pray, but it's a religious thing. You come to church and or wherever your temple is, and then you repeat something over and over again, and then go away. It's like you're just a programmed computer just saying the same things over and over and over again. God does not want that. If a husband and your wife, the wife will want her husband to love her for who she is. Praise the Lord. And the husband would expect the wife to love him for who he is, not because they are married, or she should just come and be doing my Lord, every time, without a deep reverence for him. Praise the Lord. So that's the same kind of thing that God wants. So that first Psalm, please, just read it. For me, read it.
And they slew a bullock and brought the child to Eli. Okay.
Yeah.
And she said, O my Lord, as thy soul liveth, my Lord, I am the woman that stood by thee here, praying unto the Lord. For this child I prayed, and the Lord had given me my petition, which I asked of him. Therefore also I have lent him to the Lord. As long as he liveth, he shall be lent to the Lord, and he worshipped the Lord there.
Praise the Lord. She brought her request, and God answered her prayer. Praise the Lord. So there was sorrow in her heart. There was deep pain. You know, you realize that she didn't really tell her husband. Let's go back to that First Samuel. First Samuel chapter, where will we see this? Okay. First Samuel chapter 1, verse 7. It says, verse 6, and her adversary also provoked her sore for to make her fret, because the Lord has shut up her womb. And as he did so year by year, when she went up to the house of the Lord, so she provoked her. Therefore she wept and did not eat. Then said Elkanah, her husband, to her, Hannah, why bewailest thou, and why eatest thou not? And why is thy heart grieved? Am not I better to thee than 10 sons? So what Hannah did immediately after that. So Hannah rose up after they had eaten in Shiloh, and after they had drunk. And verse 10, and she was in bitterness of soul, and prayed unto the Lord, and wept so. Praise the Lord. Her heart cried out unto God. See, at the point she was praying, and the words could not be formed from her mouth audibly, but God heard the cry of her heart. Praise the Lord. There's a song that I remember now. Is this better than a hallelujah sometimes? There's a line there that says something like, sometimes even the tears that fall down from the eyes of the one whom God loves, that love God, are better than singing, offering praises to God sometimes. Praise the Lord. You see how much God cares for us. He loves each and every one of us deeply. So then when we are Christians, we did heart for God in the first place, and we are called, it's like magnets. We are drawing two things together. How will God answer? Praise the Lord. So that's the business. So therefore, if you are not born again, forget it. It's better you enter into that family immediately. Oftentimes we wonder, why is it that I've prayed and prayed and prayed and God is not answering my prayer? Sometimes when you are talking to some Ukrainians and they'll be like, okay, they don't believe in God because there was a time they were in need and all that, and God did not, they prayed and prayed and God did not hear them. I think the question you should ask is, do you have a relationship with God in the first place? Can, for instance now, can I come to Sister Busayo's father or mother and just come and ask Sister Busayo's mother for, let me think now, school fees? You know how ridiculous that sounds? God help us in Jesus' name. Now let's look at prayer. Now prayer, there's something that was written here. It said prayer is also an instinct that must have utterance. Luke chapter 18, verse 7 and 13. Luke chapter 18, verse 7 and 13. And shall not God avenge his own elect, which cry day and night unto him, though he be along with them? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth? Verse 13 now says, and the publican, standing afar, would not lift up so much as his eyes unto heaven, but smote upon his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. That is, I think I'm understanding from here now something about a contrite heart, a repentant heart that cries up to God for forgiveness. When the message of salvation is coming to a person, for instance, you know, sometimes it's easy to just, God, please forgive me my sins. I won't do it again in Jesus' name. Amen. But then there's this, the word of God has hit with that sinner's heart and convicted the sinner that, in fact, as he's speaking to God, he doesn't even feel worthy. Of course, he's not worthy. But he cries out, God, just be merciful to me, a sinner. Look at what Jesus said. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone that exalted himself shall be abased, and he that humbled himself shall be exalted. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Thank you. Sometimes prayer is a result of an urgent call from God to his people. 1 Chronicles chapter 16, verse 11. Let's open it, please. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his face continually. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Sometimes God himself calls for prayer. Maybe this one is on a general note now. Maybe there are some things that he has revealed concerning some certain issues and all that. The first thing I think he wants is, he wants you to call upon him, because calling upon him shows him that you trust him and that he's able to deliver you. Praise the Lord. So it's not necessarily the fact of only preparing yourself, like, for instance, something comes out and you don't know how to address this. I think the first thing to do is pray. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So now we're going to be looking at how, okay, now we've learned all these things about prayer, the basis of prayer. So how are you meant to carry out this prayer as a believer? As a believer, not as a person. For a person who has not given his life to Jesus Christ, there's only one prayer for you. Ask God to forgive you your sins and bring you into his family. I don't think there's any other prayer that will be answered except by, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So how do you learn to pray? The disciples came to Jesus Christ. They had this kind of ideas before from maybe Judaism and all these things, and now they are coming to meet Jesus himself. They know that he is God, the Son of God. How do we talk to the Father? In essence, teach us how to speak to the Father. Bring us to the Father. It says, Matthew chapter 6, verse 6. But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet. And when thou hast shut thy door, pray to thy Father which is in secret. And thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. Praise the Lord. This is a method of praying, actually. From here, I can see, I don't think it's necessarily just every time you want to pray. For instance, you are here, you just, let's say you feel like praying now, you get up and go into those wardrobes and shut the door and say you want to pray. I don't think this is exactly what, sometimes this is good, most times this is good, but this is not really exactly The only thing I can draw from here. Psalm 91, verse 1 says something. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Praise the Lord. So there is a secret place where that prayer holds very strong value. What is that secret place? In essence, he who has a relationship with God, and even when people are seeing him and people are not seeing him or her, still serves God, shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. It's like you have cast your lot with God in the first place. You have pitched your tent with God. So anywhere you are, sometimes you can pray silently. Maybe there's something unfolding and the Spirit of God has just opened your eyes to see something that if you take this next step, this is what is going to happen. Or a problem is coming your way. Or maybe there's distress. Silently pray to God and God hears that kind of prayer. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. So first know that prayer must be based on the knowledge of Christ. How did Jesus Christ pray? He was always leaving the crowd, going to a mountain to pray, spend time. I was listening to another message one day and he said something. It says, it was like, why did Jesus Christ always pray? Sometimes, okay, it's true. It's good that we know that Jesus Christ prayed because he had a ministry. That's good. He had a lot of things to do. You understand? And he needed the wisdom of God, even as he was God himself, but he still needed to pray. But the preacher said something. Could it be that Jesus Christ simply always went to pray just because he loved God and he loved being in his presence? Praise the Lord. Where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. So if your treasure is not yet God, God will help you in Jesus' name. God will help us all in Jesus' name. These things that are coming out now, they are also for me. Sometimes it's hard. That's why it's sometimes hard when they say, okay, it's time to pray. And then you're looking at it as one long and tedious work. Okay, it's time to pray now. Oh, okay. And sometimes we just spend like 5 minutes, 2 minutes, and then we'll go away. I think it's because your heart is not yet centered on God. You don't yet love him. For instance, a husband and her wife. Sorry for using husband and wife, honestly, but I think that's the closest relationship we can look at now. Husband and her wife, and his wife, sorry. Even when they are apart, they travel. There should still be this longing and yearning that one day I'll return to come and meet my wife. I'm thinking about it. I'll be calling and calling and calling and calling and all that. Praise the Lord. God will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Now, how does his word teach us to pray? When you study the word, you begin to see God's own blueprint for prayer. So actually, God has his own manuscript for prayer. And that part of his spirit revealing to us all things is what enables even the newest believer in the kingdom of God, enables that believer to know how to pray unto his Father. Praise the Lord. Now, Matthew chapter 6, go back to that our text. Matthew chapter 6, verse 9 to 13. After this manner, therefore, pray, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So first of all, with a deep reverent fear of God, in all respect and love, it's a privilege actually to be able to call upon his name because he is God. Actually, human beings are, if not that God has put so much value on our lives, we are very insignificant. If you look at some things, if they are looking at the whole universe, our earth is, in fact, our solar system is nowhere to be found, just like a speck. So why, what is man that God should be mindful of him? Praise the Lord. It's a privilege that our Father can hear us and can give us his name that is above all in that, at the name of Jesus, every name must bow. Praise the Lord. It's something that is a wonderful privilege. So we should take it like that. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Jesus Christ said something. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and its righteousness, and every other thing shall be added unto you. Praise the Lord. That part of Psalms also says, in the presence of God, there's fullness of joy. At his right hand, there are pleasures evermore. So therefore, if you are seeking the kingdom of God with your prayers, how will every other thing not be added unto you? When our God is rich in everything, praise the Lord. Bible says everything good comes from God. It proceeds forth from God. So as you are asking, why not ask that, God, let your own will be done. Okay, we are in a situation where I don't know what to do. I have two choices before me, and both of them look good to me. And I'm thinking, what do I do now? Father, let your will be done. If not, if it is not your will, don't allow it to be done in my life. Praise the Lord. Because his will is always good for you. Now, how do you pray for the kingdom of God to come? Start with praying for the one you can see around you, the kingdom of God that you can see around you. What's the kingdom of God you can see around you? First of all, your own spiritual life. Then the spiritual life of your brother or your sister. Then the church. Bible also says something else. He that watereth shall be watered. Why will God not answer your prayer? God will help us understand this, Jesus' name. Now the next thing is this. Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Then we can now begin to make our requests known unto God. There are some times that drastic measures have to be taken. Maybe for instance, something just happens. Accident, or you're in an accident or something like that. Something is about to happen and right then you have to make a choice in a split second. What are you going to do? At that point in time, I think it's best to just cry out and call upon the name of God. Especially if you are a Christian. Praise the Lord. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Especially if you know, you have this conviction in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord and he is my Lord. So therefore, God, we have this covenant together. You have promised me a lot of things. And I know that your thoughts towards me are good and not of evil. Deliver me. Praise the Lord. God help us in Jesus' name. Now, says, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Matthew chapter 6, verse 15. But if you forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. These are some of the things that make our prayers not be answered sometimes. You are coming to God to pray, and then you have unforgiveness in your heart. Forget it. God is not going to answer that prayer until you deal with that thing in your heart. That part of the scripture that also says, when you come to the altar with your gift, and then you remember that your brother has ought against you, leave your gift there at the altar. First, go and settle it with your brother, and then come again and offer your gift. It's the same thing in the place of prayer. Realize that the Christian life, everything you do is a sacrifice, is an offering unto God. Playing the instruments, singing, even breathing, even as you are praying, is an offering unto God. Bible talks about it in Revelation, about the offering, the prayers of the saints coming up as a sweet smelling savor unto God. Praise the Lord. If the savor that is coming to God is good in some part, but just in the middle, a trickle of unforgiveness is coming. His eyes are too holy to behold iniquity. He will not answer that prayer. God help us understand in Jesus' name. So forgive, let go. Lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom. See, this last part must never be omitted. Don't forget to thank God. In fact, I believe more effort should be spent in praising God, thanking him for what he has done in advance. Praise the Lord. There's also the part of praise in prayer. Praise is a form of, all of them are offerings unto God. Praise the Lord. So when you are also praising God, let's say you have something that you want from God, but you are just praising him. Thank you, because I know you have already done it. You are not flattering him. Not flattering. Praise the Lord. There's a difference between praising God and also flattering him. Something here says, the only type of praise that moves the heart of God is that which is done out of a righteous heart. One that has been made pure by the Lord himself. A heart that appreciates the righteousness, purity, and the beauty of the holiness of God. Knowing that it is a privilege to be a partaker of such a gift is the only heart that can offer an acceptable sacrifice of praise to God. Every other type of praise is flattery, meaning absolutely nothing. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I think we should learn this today. When you have something, look at Jesus Christ. Look at what he did. Remember when he was in front of Lazarus' tomb and all those things had been happening? The first thing he did was thank God. Father, I thank you because it. Let's open that part of the Bible. Praise the Lord. Who knows what where it is in the Bible? John chapter 11. Verse 41. It says, then they took... Okay, we see something here. 34 and 35. Or 33. When Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews also weeping with, which came with her, he groaned in the spirit and was troubled. There was a trouble in his heart. There was something in his heart. The father saw it, obviously. Praise the Lord. And said, where have you laid him? They said unto him, Lord, come and see. 35. Jesus wept. Praise the Lord. So there was this groaning in the spirit. Why did they start complaining that, God, why could you allow this to happen? Why is it that I didn't even go there? If Jesus was a man, just imagine. That's what many of us would do. God, why did you allow Lazarus to die? You know how much he meant to me and all that. Start complaining, complaining. God, I know you can do everything. Just do it. Are we talking to God? Then he just says, verse 41, then they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me. And I knew that thou hearest me always. But because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me. And when he had thus spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And he that was dead came forth, bound hand and foot with grave clothes. And his face was bound about with a napkin. And Jesus said unto him, loose him and let him go. Praise the Lord. Amen. So the first thing Jesus Christ did in many situations was thank God. When he wanted to feed the 5,000 people with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fishes, he raised it up, gave a blessing. He said, lifted up his eyes to heaven and blessed and break and gave. Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. So that's one thing we must never forget to do. Because human beings, sometimes we can be very ungrateful. After God has done everything for you, in the next situation, when you are in that same kind of problem again, you forget it and complain. Me myself, I've been guilty of this a lot of times. But then you realize that God is always faithful. Why not just thank him? God will help us in Jesus' name. And let's move on. What is the essence of prayer? What is the whole purpose of prayer? What does it really entail? Apart from all the requests, prayer requests. What is the whole thing inside? What is the whole point of it? Praise the Lord. Something I wrote here, I think that just summarizes everything. If you love God, you will talk with him. So, I think that's all. Praise the Lord. If you love God, if you love Jesus Christ, you will talk with him. That should be a marker on all our hearts too. If you love him, you will talk with him. Something I'm learning too. If I love God, I will speak to him. If I love God, before I complain, I will talk to him. If I love God, I will love to dwell in his presence. Praise the Lord. Now, how are we supposed to not pray, or how are we not supposed to pray? Proverbs chapter 15, verse 29. Proverbs 15, verse 29. Let's read it. I think we should read it together. The Lord is far from the wicked, but he heareth the prayer of the righteous. Praise the Lord. That's also a reemphasis. Most of us who come from Christian homes, we come from a Christian country, at least majority of the country, we are Christians there. And then we have this idea about God, and we know what is good, and we know what is wrong. We know that God exists, so we believe in him. We cannot be moved again by maybe an atheist, depending on the kind of person you are, anyway, that will come and tell you that there is no God. But then the thing that many people forget is this. God is not a sugar daddy. He's not a person that's just there to at your beck and call. No, he desires righteousness. Praise the Lord. Don't you think God has his own will too? Don't you even think that God has his own request of you too? Praise the Lord. That's the first thing. He hears the prayer of the righteous. So forget any other. Like, come and demonstrate. Shake your head. Dance, fast, and all that. Your heart is not right with God. Your prayer is not passing the ceiling. Come help us in Jesus' name. Second, with doubt in your heart. This is one thing that I finally got the understanding of it, and I'm still learning it too. James chapter 1, verse 6 to 7. But let him ask in faith, not in wavering. Let's read verse 5. It says, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. But let him ask in faith, not in wavering. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. Praise the Lord. God does not like inconsistency. God does not like you are coming to him. Father, good morning. I've been in this kind of situation and so much trouble and all that. I've been suffering. I know you are seeing me, but I don't know why I've not done anything about it. But anyway, I know, I don't know whether you can do it or not, but if you can do it, please do it. Imagine that kind of request. If somebody comes and
tells you that thing,
for instance,
even as a human being,
you go and talk to a professor or something like that, or your father, I don't know if you have the money to pay my school fees or not, but anyway, since you are my father, I want school fees. He will not answer you. He may not answer you. He may even slap you. Now imagine what we do to God when we come with him, come to him with that heart. Silently, we don't know we are doing it. That's just the thing. Sometimes we don't know we are doing it. Sometimes we know, but we can't help it. Praise the Lord. So that's why we need the Holy Spirit to help us when we want to pray. Even if you want to pray, it's so hard. Holy Spirit, help my heart. Jesus Christ, that man that wanted his son to be healed and the disciples had come, it's like the manifestation of what the disciples had done had already even lessened his faith in a way. They had come, everybody is casting out, nothing is happening. So when Jesus Christ came, do you believe? Lord, I believe. Help my own belief. Praise the Lord. Now we know that everything good comes from God. Even that faith you think you don't have, you know you don't have, or that trust in God you know you don't have, why not start with that? Father, please help me to trust you. Help me. Help me. As I want to pray this prayer, help me. As I'm in this situation, help me. Pray God to help us in Jesus' name. And then we learned about this also. With unforgiveness in your heart, God will not answer your prayer. It's just sure. It's God. He can choose to do whatever he wants to do. And that's the way he chooses. Praise the Lord. So therefore, what do we need to be praying for? Now that we know how, by the special grace of God, what do we need to ask for? Matthew chapter 7, verse 7. Ask and it shall be given to you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh receiveth, and he that seeketh findeth, and to him that knocketh it shall be opened. Or what man is there of you, whom if his son asks bread, will he give him a stone? Or if he asks a fish, will he give him a serpent? If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your Father, which is in heaven, give good things to them that ask him? Praise the Lord. Therefore, all things whatsoever you would that men should do to you, do ye even so to them. For this is the law and the prophets. Praise the Lord. What are we supposed to be asking for? You can actually ask anything of the Father according to his will. Ephesians chapter 6. Okay, let's start with Ephesians chapter 3. Verse 14. For this cause I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that he, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ with perfect knowledge, that he might be filled with all the fullness of God. Praise the Lord. Remember the Lord's prayer, thy kingdom come. The contents of our prayer, by God's grace, especially the ones we do in our secret place, should also be for your brethren. Praise the Lord. These are some of the things we should be asking God for. He's my brother. He's going through so many things. Lord, please help him, strengthen his faith. Okay, there are some people who have not yet come to knowledge of salvation. Lord, please let them come to the knowledge of salvation. Encounter their hearts. Use me, O Lord, that I may be a vessel to reach out to the nations. All these kind of prayers, they are in God's will. And God is going to use a man. Don't you think he's going to give him everything that is required to take him to that place? God, help us in Jesus' name. Praying for the saints, praying for our brethren. Okay. Then finally, Ephesians chapter 6, from verse 18. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. And watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. And for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel. Praise the Lord. So we should pray in the Spirit for every saint, for our leaders, for our church, for the kingdom of God to be established. Sometimes even before we bring our own request to God's God. Praise the Lord. Jesus Christ spent, I think, the first part of his ministry and the last part of his ministry praying for his people. The whole of John chapter 17, if you look at it, Jesus talked to the Father. He prayed for his disciples that were there. He prayed for the people that his disciples would talk to. He even prayed for you and I. God will help us to understand in Jesus' name. These are the things that the Father wants. I believe God is trying to tell us something. First of all, bringing us back to the basis. So that we'll not just do this thing religiously. First of all, do you love God? If you do not love him, ask him to help you. He's the one that will help you to love him. That's the beautiful thing about it. Praise the Lord. If you do not love him, really, ask him about it. Tell him. Then also now we know how not to pray. I don't know why, but the one of the grievous things you can do, a believer can do to the Holy Spirit, is have unforgiveness in his heart. If you have that thing there, the Holy Spirit leaves you. That will not be our portion in Jesus' name. Then we should pray God's will. James chapter 4, verse 3. Let's just read this. Ye ask and receive not, because ye ask amiss, that ye may consume it upon your lust. Praise the Lord. Ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. Pray God will help us act according to his will in Jesus' name. And I think we need to pray now. We have learned it. And the basis of it, the basis of what God wants from us is a relationship, because that is what will take us to heaven. The Spirit of God has been given to us for that purpose, for all men to know God, that we may know Christ. And if we know Christ, I believe every other thing else will follow. Do you have a relationship with God? Do you love him? Do you love him above every other thing? Do you love to dwell in his presence? If not, I think it's time to ask God. Because every other thing else will be easy to do. It will be easy to work for him. It will be easy to obey him. It will be easy to give your money, your tithe, whatever it is. For the missions and all these things, it will be easy to obey instructions. Let's just ask the Holy Spirit, Lord, show me Jesus Christ and help me to love him.